بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. So now we enter into chapter 4. This is for those of you who have the book. We're on page 250. Chapter 4, the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and asking peace for him and the obligation of doing it and its excellence. Section 1, the meaning of the prayer on the Prophet. قال المصنف رحمه الله ونفعنا بعلومه في الدارين آمين. Allah Ta'ala says, Allah and His angels pray for blessings on the Prophet. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي. Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما said that the meaning of this is that Allah Ta'ala and His angels invoke blessings on the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. It is said that Allah Ta'ala showers mercy on the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and His angels supplicate for him. Al-Mubarrad said, the root of the prayer is invoking mercy. It is mercy from Allah Ta'ala, and from the angels it is graciousness and a supplication for Allah's mercy. It is related in the hadith describing the prayer of the angels for someone who sits waiting for the prayer, that they say, O Allah, forgive him. O Allah, show mercy to him. This is the supplication that they make. Abu Bakr al-Qushayri said, the prayer from Allah Ta'ala is for mercy. For anyone else other than the Prophet ﷺ, and for the Prophet, it is a distinction and more honor. So the whole point of the section is when we read in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his angels send prayers on the Prophet ﷺ, well, what is Allah praying for the Prophet ﷺ mean? That's the issue of this section. So he's telling us, well, with that, for Allah, that means Allah bestowing mercy on the Prophet ﷺ. Abu Ali said the prayer of Allah Ta'ala and his praise is his praise and of the Prophet ﷺ to the angels. The prayer of the angels is supplication. So when the angels do salawat, it's that they are making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ made a distinction between salah, prayer, and barakah, blessing.
Recording in progress.
In which he taught about making the prayer on him. As for the prayer asking for peace on the Prophet with Allah Ta'ala, which Allah Ta'ala has commanded his servants to do, Qadi Abu Bakr ibn Bukayr said, this verse was sent down on the Prophet and Allah Ta'ala commanded his companions to ask for peace on him. Similarly, those after him were commanded to ask for peace on the Prophet ﷺ when they were present at his grave and when he is mentioned. There are three possibilities contained by the expression As-salamu alaykum. Number one, it means safety, salam, for you and with you, taking the word salam, peace, as a verbal noun. Number two, As-salam means your protection, being guarded on your preservation. In this case, it is As-Salam as the name of Allah Ta'ala. As-Salam in the meaning of Musalama, reconciliation, and submission to him, as in the words of Allah Ta'ala, know by your Lord they are not believers until they make you their judge and their disputes break out between them, and then find no distance within themselves to what you decide and submit themselves completely. Okay, so this is, you know, what is As-Salatu and As-Salam. What are these two that come from the verse? So now we have a sense that there's kind of a width of meaning regarding that. Section two, the judgment concerning the prayer on the Prophet. Know that since Allah Ta'ala has commanded that he be blessed, the prayer on the Prophet is a general obligation, not restricted to a specific time. So in the Sharia, we have obligations that have a specific time, like the prayers, like zakah, hajj, Ramadan, you know, they come at specific times. And then we have obligations that are open-ended. This is the one of those things that's open-ended. The imams and the ulama are in agreement on its obligatory nature. Abu Ja'far al-Tabari, however, said that he thought this verse only gives it the level of being mandub, recommended, claiming a consensus for that. This may refer to doing it more than once. The obligation involved in it, the performance of which eliminates the wrong action, which would be incurred by not doing it, is to do it at least once, as in the case of bearing witness to his prophethood, السلام, doing it more than this is desirable and recommended in the Sunnah of Islam. In other words, if there is a command that we send prayers and salutations on the Prophet, السلام, what is the minimal amount that we have to do it to remove from us the sin of not doing it? That's what he's saying. And that's the sort of how the Sharia, you know, that's a legal discussion. So he says, the minimum is that we do it at least once in our life, is that when we are of age and, you know, we are hit puberty, that is, and we say the shahada, you know, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once, at least once in our life, to have done the testification of faith. And then therefore, after that, every, you know, every time after that is a sunnah. Of course, we're not going to do that. We're going to do it all the time. But I mean, I'm just trying to explain to you why he's saying it the way he's saying it. Qadi Abu al-Hasan, I mean, if you love the Prophet, you're not going to take that. You're going to say, I have to do it all the time. Qadi Abu al-Hasan ibn Qasar said that his companions maintain that there is a general obligation to do it once in a lifetime while one is capable of it. Qadi Abu Bakr ibn Bukayr said, Allah Ta'ala obliges his creation to pray on his Prophet وسلم, and for peace on him, and he did not assign that to a specific time. Man's obligation is to do it often and not neglect it. Qadi Abu Bakr ibn Nasr said, the prayer on the Prophet وسلم, is a general obligation. Qadi Abu Bakr Abdullah Muhammad ibn Sa'id said, the position of Malik, his companions and other people of knowledge is that the prayer on the Prophet ﷺ is a general obligation conditional on belief. It is not specific to the obligatory prayer. However, whoever blesses him once in his life has removed the obligation. The followers of Imam al-Shafi'i say that the obligation which Allah Ta'ala and his messenger ﷺ commanded applies to the obligatory prayer. In other instances, there is no disagreement that it is not obligatory. So in the Shafi'i madhab, for us, we have to say the shahada and the prayers on the Prophet والسلام, in the salah, in the prayer itself. It's one of the conditions for the validity of the prayer. That's what he's saying. And of course, Qadi Ayad, the author, rahimahullah, he's a Maliki. So a lot of the legal discussions that he talks about, he invokes the Maliki jurists for that, which is fine. I'm just pointing it out so people know what's going on. The two Imams, Abu Ja'far al-Tabari and al-Tahawi and others relate the consensus of the early and later ulama of the community that the prayer on the Prophet ﷺ in the Tashahud is not obligatory. As Shafi'i is the exception, saying that any prayer lacking the prayer of the Prophet ﷺ after the last Tashahud before saying Salaamu Alaikum warahmatullah is invalid, and also that it is not permissible to say it before this. And as a matter of fact, Imam al-Shafi'i, because his great emphasis on this and specifically love of the family of the Prophet ﷺ, at sometimes during his life, he was accused of being a Shia. As a matter of fact, he got essentially arrested when he was in Yemen. He got arrested on suspicion that he was a Shia trying to usurp political power, which is hilarious because, you know, he's the furthest one, you know, from that type of politics at his time. And his clever mind, alhamdulillah, got him out of that. But that's how he ended up going to Baghdad in his first trip. Anyway, I digress. He had no precedent for this statement nor any observed sunnah. So Qadi Ayad here is criticizing the legal position of Imam al-Shafi'i, which is normal. This is how jurists talk on legal matters. He went in excess in making the statement since he hoped others before him and people like At-Tabari and Al-Qushayri have censored him for that. So, you know, when it comes to legal issues, the ulama will dispute legal position. That's just the nature of the law. Abu Bakr ibn Mundhir said it is recommended that no one pray without blessing the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, if the prayer on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is omitted, then the prayer is still valid, according to the school of Malik, the people of Medina, Sufyan al-Thawri, and the people of Kufa and others. Malik and Sufyan relate that it is recommended to say it in the last tashahud, and that it is disliked to omit it from the final tashahud. Ash-Shafi'i is the one exception, saying that if it is omitted from the prayer must be repeated. So, of course, the dispute here is the legal nature of saying the salawat formula in the prayer. None of these people deny the importance of doing salawat on the Prophet ﷺ. But Imam Ash-Shafi'i, in my madhab, we are saying that if you don't do it, then the prayer is not valid. So they're critiquing that aspect. It's a legal aspect. Again, I'm just repeating so we understand what's happening. Ishaq ibn Ibrahim says that the prayer should be repeated if it is omitted intentionally, but not if it is due to forgetfulness. Abu Muhammad ibn Abi Zayd related from Muhammad al-Mawaz that the prayer on the Prophet ﷺ is a duty. Abu Muhammad Yazid said he means that it is not one of the obligations of the prayer, but a general obligation. Muhammad ibn al-Hakam and others, Ibn al-Qassar and Abdul Wahhab, related that Muhammad al-Mawaz thought it was an obligation in the prayer like a Shafi'i. Abu Ya'la al-Abdi al-Maliki related that Malik school has three positions about it, that it is obligatory, that it is a sunnah, and that it is recommended. Al-Khattabi and other Shafi'ites disagree with a Shafi'i. Al-Khattabi said it is not obligatory in the prayer. That is the statement of the Fuqaha, with the exception of a Shafi'i, and I do not know his precedent for it. The proof that it is not one of the obligations of the prayer is what a Salaf before a Shafi'i did and their disagreement about and their agreement about it. People have criticized him for saying that when he did, a Shafi'i chose the Tashahud, which the Prophet ﷺ taught Ibn Mas'ud, and which does not contain the prayer on the Prophet ﷺ. Similarly, with Abu Huraira, Ibn Abbas, Jabir, Ibn Umar, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, radiallahu anhum, who relate that the tashahud from the Prophet, they do not mention the Prophet, meaning these are the different narrations that come of the hadith talking about what you say in the tashahud. Ibn Abbas and Jabir said the Prophet taught us the tashahud in the same way he taught us the surahs of the Quran. Ibn Umar said Abu Bakr used to teach us the tashahud on the minbar as children are taught at school. Umar ibn al-Khattab also taught it on the minbar. There is a hadith which says there is no prayer for someone who does not pray on me. Ibn al-Qasar said that this means that the prayer is not complete without it, or alternatively, it refers to someone who has not prayed on him once in his entire lifetime. The people of hadith all consider the transmission of this hadith to be weak. Abu Ja'far related from Ibn Mas'ud that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever does the prayer and does not bless me and the people of my house in it will not have their prayer accepted. Ad-Dariqutni said the correct version is what Abu Ja'far Muhammad ibn Hussein said, which is, if I were to offer a prayer in which I did not bless the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the people of his house, I think that it was incomplete. So there are some traditions, even though there is weakness, that support the other position. Some people joined a little bit later. I do realize that Maghrib time is soon, so I'm going to go right up until Maghrib time, and then I'll discuss with the administration that maybe moving forward we should bring up the class time half an hour to accommodate Maghrib prayer. I apologize if for that. Section 3, on the situations in which it is recommended to say the prayer on the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So I think if I'm lucky, we'll just do these three pages. We have already stated that it is desirable to say the prayer on the Prophet ﷺ and the tashahud before the supplication. Fadala ibn Ubayd, so that means to say, you know, after at-tahiyyatu lillahi wa salatu, after that you say, ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That would be the minimal amount. That extra part, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's what we're talking about. Fadala ibn Ubayd said that the Prophet ﷺ heard a man making supplication in his prayer without blessing the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ said, this is hasty. Then he called him and told him and the others, when one of you prays, he should begin with praise of Allah and then prayer, pray on the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and then make whatever supplication he wishes. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu stated, supplication and prayer are suspended between the heaven and the earth, and none of it rises to Allah until they pray on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Ali alayhi salam related something similar and added, and on the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is related that supplication is veiled until the one making the supplication prays on the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Ibn Mas'ud said, when one of you wants to ask Allah Ta'ala for something, he should begin by praising and extolling him as he deserves and then bless the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then his supplication is more likely to be successful. Jabir said that the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, do not make me like a rider's jug. The rider fills his jug, then puts it down and hoists upon his baggage. If he needs to drink, he drinks, or if he needs to do wudu, he does so. If not, he pours it away. Rather, put me at the beginning of the supplication, the middle, and the end. Ibn Atta said, supplication has pillars, wings, means, and moments. If its pillars are accepted, it is strong. If its wings are accepted, it flies. If its moments are accepted, it has success. If its means are accepted, it wins. Its pillars are presence of the heart, compassion, humility, humbleness, and the heart being suspended before Allah Ta'ala and cut from the reliance on means. Its means are the prayer on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. The hadith says the supplication between the two prayers is not rejected. Another hadith says every supplication is veiled from heaven, and when the prayer on me is made, then it ascends. At the end of Ibn Abbas's supplication, which Hanash related from him, he said, hear my supplication, begin with the prayer on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and say, O Allah, I ask you to bless Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, your slave and prophet and messenger, with the best of what you blessed any of your creatures. Ameen. Among the situations when it is good to pray on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are when he is mentioned, when his name is heard or written, and during the adhan. So anytime we mention the name of the Prophet, we say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise, when we hear the adhan, obviously we repeat behind the muadhin. And when we write his name, alayhi salatu wasalam, the sunnah is to write out sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Not to write like S or some kind of shortcut. That's actually considered makruh, disliked in the Sharia. It's either you write it out or you don't write it at all. So you don't have to write it every single time. I mean, the Salaf didn't necessarily write it in their documents, write it out all the time, because every time they wrote it, they said it. So writing it out is something that came later, which is fine. But then making it a shortcut like an S, or in the Arabic, a sad only, like for sallallahu, that's considered rude, actually. And we don't do that. So either you write it out or you don't write it, or you just say it orally. The Prophet ﷺ said, dust be upon the face of the man who does not bless me when I am mentioned in his presence. You see, because of all of these hadith, Imam al-Shafi'i leaned towards that position. Always, I'm a Shafi'i, so I'm always going to push that. Lean towards that position that you have to do it in the prayer. Ibn Habib disliked mentioning the Prophet ﷺ when sacrificing animals. Sahnun, who was one of the companions or one of the elders of the Maliki Madhab, disliked anyone saying the prayer on the Prophet ﷺ when amazed, and said, the prayer on him should only be done with consideration and seeking its reward. Asbagh related that Al-Qasim said, the two situations when only Allah Ta'ala is mentioned are during the sacrifice and when you sneeze. You do not say Muhammad is the messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam after mentioning them. If you say after mentioning Allah, may Allah bless Muhammad, it is not the same as naming him along with Allah. Ashhab said the prayer on the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam should not be made a sunnah in it, meaning that when you know, alhamdulillah, when you sneeze, there's no prayer on the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in that instance. And Nasa'i related from Aus ibn Aus from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and commanded the command to do much prayer on him on Friday. So Friday is one of the days in which is meritorious to make extra salawat on the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And actually there's a practice, and maybe one of us would like to revive this practice at our masjid, is that there's a practice that after Fajr on Fridays, there's a gathering for salawat, for prayers on the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, to comply with that hadith. So many of the pious people and the people of the Salaf, they had these different gatherings where they would come together and they would do salawat on the Prophet either out loud or silently. The shortest tashahud that we can say, التحيات لله والصلوات الطيبات السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. That would be the shortest amount. One of the situations for the prayer on him is when entering a mosque. Abu Ishaq ibn Sha'ban said, anyone who enters the mosque should bless the Prophet ﷺ and his family and ask for abundant mercy and blessings and peace on him and his family. He should say, O Allah, forgive me my wrong actions and open for me the doors of your mercy. When he leaves, he should do the same and say bounty instead of mercy. Amr ibn Dinar, speaking about the words of Allah Ta'ala, when you enter the houses, then greet each other. He said, if there is no one in the house, then you say, peace be upon the Prophet of mercy and the mercy of Allah and his blessings. Peace be upon us and upon the right acting slaves of Allah. Peace be upon the people of the house and the mercy of Allah and his blessings. Ibn Abbas said that what is meant by houses in this instances were the mosques. And Nakhai said, when there is no one in the mosque, say, peace be upon the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When there's no one in the house, say, peace be upon the people of the house, the mercy of Allah and his blessings. As-salamu ala ahli al-bayt wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Al-Qama said, when I enter the mosque, I say, peace be upon you, O Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the mercy of Allah and his blessings. May Allah Ta'ala and his angels pray upon Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ka'b said something similar when he entered and left, but he did not include the second half. Ibn Sha'ban said, use the hadith of Fatima alayhi salam, the daughter of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as proof. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say it when he entered the mosque. Something similar is related by Abu Bakr ibn Amr ibn Hazm. He mentioned asking for peace and mercy on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with a slightly different wording. The funeral prayer is another situation in which the prayer on the Prophet ﷺ is said. After the second takbir, we do the salah on the Prophet ﷺ. Abu Usama al-Ansari said that doing so is part of the sunnah. One of the situations in which the community says the prayers on the Prophet ﷺ and his family, and there's no objection to it, is when writing letters after the basmala. So when we write a letter to somebody, you would write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, or something like that. Of course, no one writes letters anymore, I understand, but that's something that needs to be kept, you know, revived. This was not done in the early times, as I mentioned to you earlier, but began during the government of Banu Hashim, meaning the Abbasids, and people continued to use it in various places. Some people finish letters with it. So people that are into manuscripts, and there's a whole like cult of Muslim academics and scholars who are into manuscripts, you will see in the handwriting of these great imams in the past, in the original documents, you know, sometimes they'll write it on every single page, or they'll begin with it, they'll end with it, so on and so forth. One of the situations in which the community says the prayer on the... No, I said that, sorry. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever blesses me in a book or a letter, the angels continue to ask forgiveness for him as long as my name is in it. And I want to show you something. Because of this hadith, I have this... Oops, I have my own habit that anytime I always have a notebook with me, at least one notebook, you know, for work and if I have meetings and, you know, just things like that. So every time I have a notebook and I buy a notebook, the first thing I do is I open the notebook and then I write out, you know, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. just to comply with this hadith. So this is like my work notebook, and I have a small notebook that if I don't have a handbag or a briefcase, and you know, same thing, you open the cover and you'll find the same formula written. So this is based on this hadith. The Prophet, just to repeat, the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever blesses me in a book or a letter, the angels continue to ask forgiveness for him as long as my name is on it. So I know this hadith, or I knew it. And then one time I was in Fez in Morocco, and I was in the old city. And this was many, 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 many years ago. And I found like a little book stand. And I found Sheikh al-Islam Zakaria al-Ansari, who is a major figure in the Shafi'i Madhab. He has a commentary on the Risala al-Qushariya, which is a very famous book of tasawwuf, which I hope, inshallah, Allah give us tawfiq for us to finish this book. And after this book, that's the book that I want to teach. It was a thin volume. It was a very old print, so I purchased it. And when I opened the book, almost on every single page, the previous owner of the book had written, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And I put two and two together. I said, oh, that's how you implement this hadith. So ever since that moment, and I still have that book. It's not with me. It's back home. But ever since I saw that, that's what I do when I have a notebook. So it's like easy, continual thawab, inshallah. I share only so I can encourage you to do the same. Okay, Maghrib is up, almost upon us. Let me just finish this page. You should ask for peace on the Prophet ﷺ in the tashahud of the prayer. Abdullah bin Mas'ud said that the Prophet ﷺ said, when one of you prays, let him say greetings, prayers, and good things belong to Allah. Peace be upon you, O Prophet, and the mercy of Allah and his blessings. If you say that, it will reach every right acting slave in the heaven and the earth. This is one of the situations in which to ask for peace on him. It is sunnah to do it at the beginning of the tashahud. Although Malik said that Ibn Umar used to say it when he finished the tashahud. In al-Mabsut, Malik recommended that it be said with the final salam. Muhammad ibn Maslama said he meant that Aisha alayhi salam and Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu used to say in their salam, peace be upon you, O Prophet, and the mercy of Allah and his blessings, and peace be upon us and the right acting slaves of Allah, peace be upon you. Meaning the formula of the tahiyyat. The people of knowledge recommend that in his salam, a man should intend to greet every right acting slave in the heaven and the earth, amongst the angels, the children of Adam and the jinn. Malik said in his collection, it is preferred for someone following the imam. When the imam says salam, he would say, peace be upon the Prophet and the mercy of Allah and his blessings. Peace be upon us and upon the right acting slaves. Peace be upon you. Wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam wa sallallahumma ala sayyidina wa maulana Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So I'll put a pause here. I know that Maghrib is coming in, but just quickly, if there are any questions, please let me know.
Thank you very much. For all this, thank you very much. We have in Kashmir every after Fajr, we sit there and first say, Alhamdulillah, Subhanallah. Then after that, we say Salawat for Muhammad Salawat. So for about, it takes about half an hour every Fajr after Fajr, every time. It takes it all Salawats upon our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
Oh, mashallah. Okay, on Fridays?
On Friday, this is in Awrad Fatah. On every day, not on Friday, on every
after
day.
Every Fajr. Okay, great. Alhamdulillah. Well, I'm glad that we do that. Alhamdulillah. Okay, I hear the adhan.
From ICCP. From ICCP.
And I have another hour or so until Fajr. So, okay, I'll end here so that you can pray Maghrib, and then I'll discuss with Brother Mohsin and Aisha about maybe changing the time for the next few Fridays to make it earlier. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen wa sallillahumma ala Sayyidina Mawlana Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli afdala salatin ala as'adi makhlouqatika Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala آله وصحبه وسلم عدد معلوماتك ومداد كلماتك كلما ذكرك الذاكرون وغفل عن ذكره الغافلون. Talk to you all soon, inshallah. Be well. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.